Good morning and a warm welcome to the 9th meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2024. We've received apologies from Megan Gallagher MSP and Keith Brown MSP. Mr Brown is substituted by Kevin Stewart and can invite Mr Stewart to declare any relevant interests.
Relevant interests, Convener.
Thank you very much. Our first agenda item is a decision in taking business in private. Are members content to take item 3 in private? Thank you. Our next agenda item is to continue to take evidence on the committee's inquiry on the review of the EU-UK Trade and Cooperation Agreement. And we are joined this morning by Tavish Scott, Chief Executive of Salmon Scotland. Welcome, I'm sure you familiar with this room, Mr Scott. Donna Ferdice, Chief Executive of Seafood Scotland. Scott Walker, Executive Manager, Scottish Meat Wholesalers.
Good morning.
And Fiona Burnett, Technical Director of Scottish Quality Crops. And a warm welcome to you all, and thank you for the submission to the committee prior to today's evidence session. In the submission, Seafood Scotland highlights that the customs rules of origin and the sanitary phytosanitary requirements have added a considerable time and cost burden to Scottish traders. Scottish Quality Crops suggests that recognising equivalence in SPS standards across EU and GB borders would be welcome, and Salmon Scotland seek to as bespoke and mutually convenient SPS and veterinary agreement. I'd like to understand the particular challenges just briefly, and also what would you want to see from such an agreement? What would it look like from your point of view? And perhaps I can begin with Mr. Scott.
Yeah, thank you very much, Convener, and thank you very much for the invitation to offer some thoughts to your committee this morning. In short, the best way to describe this is the route that salmon takes from harvest on the west coast of Scotland or in the islands, all the way through the Central Belt and in particular the logistics hubs, through to the Channel Tunnel and then to Boulogne-sur-Mer, which is where most salmon, and indeed, as Donna will reflect, most seafood goes in terms of the route into the European Union, as opposed to Heathrow for wider markets in North America and in Asia. That very tight logistics route was made more challenging by the departure from the European Union, both in terms of the time taken for journeys because of the extra paperwork that we as a third country now have to comply with, which is obviously previously wasn't the case, and secondly in terms of the cost that added to the business journey. So it's probably those factors, cost to business, the time taken on for the journey, which of course is really important in the context of a time-sensitive product. Fish, after all, we're selling fresh fish into Paris, Monte Carlo, Berlin, etc. And there the consumer demands that, or the retailer, the consumer, the wholesaler demands that fish to obviously be pristine. And the other aspect to that is that we're competing with our good friends and colleagues in Norway who will equally say that they can provide product into those marketplaces. So all of this added to that market pressure that we face. And we've absorbed those costs because that's what business has to do. We've continued to seek better trading arrangements, which is the second part of your question in relation to what comes in the future. But the fundamentals are bureaucracy, cost, time that we face as businesses, and those cost, in our case, the salmon industry, around £3 million extra a year.
Thank you very much. Could I go to Ms. Burnett next?
Obviously, SPS measures have benefits as well as downsides. And broadly for cereals and oilseeds, the combinable crops that the SQC scheme covers, the impacts are fairly minimal. We welcome the fact that the measures are now risk-based so that grain, other than for seed, is at very low risk of inspections and measures. And that contrasts with something like potatoes, which are not in our scheme. But obviously are still unable to be traded with Europe. So broadly, that kind of risk-based approach is positive. In our evidence, we highlighted, though, a couple of issues. So the idea of equivalence when it comes to the Renewable Energy Directive where we've had difficulty because UCAS, who is our national body, was not recognised by Europe. So it's these, you know, just difficulties. And that's, it's a relatively small market relative to other grain and cereal markets, but we still estimate it probably adds about £10 a tonne to grain. So on, you know, over 3 million tonnes, that's a significant kind of lift to the market. We know that there's difficulties transporting samples, so that we have less intelligence on new variants of diseases and pests. So that's another hindrance. And going forward, we worry about any kind of divergence. So, you know, our scheme's about safety and credibility. So anything around a divergence on chemicals, pesticides, the regulation that talks about protected zones and the diseases that are relevant. So we just need to stay engaged. So the success of equivalence for us would be that we remain engaged with the agencies in Europe that, you know, decide on these things.
Thank you. Ms. Paradise, do you want to go next?
Yeah, I'll just build on as well what Tavish said in the well capture and the shellfish. For a lot of our processors, it's really reduced the time that they have. So they actually buy the fish on the market that morning, so the fish isn't getting to their premises till maybe 8, 9 o'clock. Normally, the groupage vehicles would collect that around about 2 o'clock. Now that's had to be 12 o'clock. So a lot tighter window, plus being able to do all of the additional paperwork, has really put a burden on a lot of the smaller processors. And actually, when Brexit hit, the groupage collapsed. So we use a groupage system. So for companies prior to Brexit, dealing with France was just like dealing with Glasgow. So it was a very, very simple process. And now all of that was added in and the additional costs. So companies maybe had 10 customers who were maybe buying 5, 10 kilos from them every day, and that was being sold every day. The cost prohibited that, so many of the small businesses now stop exporting into Europe and have just really focused on the UK market, which is a real shame. So then, we've, you know, it's just putting smaller businesses either out of business or reducing their market share.
Thank you, Mr. Walker.
Thank you very much for the opportunity today. I speak about the red meat industry, so I won't go over all the same ground that has been covered because the points raised by both Tavish and Donna are equally equivalent to the red meat industry. Just pick on a couple of things before talking, though, about future arrangements and improvements that can be made. In terms of groupage, that was a big impact for the smaller meat processors in Scotland, who rely upon groupage and can't send across containers themselves. There's only one haulier now that's involved in the groupage for red meat, and the route they take is Hull to Zeebrugge. And as a result of that, that means certain markets in Europe can't be accessed now. So markets that used to be very profitable, such as Monaco, just can't be accessed in the times required. So that's had a big impact upon them and resulted in the loss of markets. But if I look then to the future as to what sort of improvements could be made to simplify the process, and I think the key bits to focus on is bureaucracy and cost. But even regardless of any future arrangements that could be put in place, there's still going to be costs that can't be eliminated. So import costs, duty costs to go into Europe. So even throughout all the simplification process, if it is at all possible, there's still going to be a cost burden that's facing the industry. And those costs represent money that could otherwise have been invested here domestically in Scotland to improve businesses, improve efficiencies and grow firms. But if I look into the future, what I would say first and foremost is electronic documentation. The more we can actually move the documentation to electronic forms to simplify the process of getting it onto the various databases and remove errors, that probably would be the single biggest win for the industry. It would reduce the extra time and effort and people that are now employed in meat plants just to cope with the paperwork that goes forward, and probably still remains the single biggest point of friction as you get to border control points in Europe. So that'd be the first one. When we look then at SPS agreements going forward, they could be actually anything, potentially. And for me, I would separate them into two big issues. One about public health, and the second one about animal health. And if we concentrate on the second one first, about animal health, in terms of how we operate just now in Scotland, is still very much aligned with how things operate in Europe. But we've got to verify all that each time and got to prove that that is the case, hence the very complicated export health certificates that have to accompany each load that goes to Europe. And depending on the products that you're exporting, because most containers will have a number of mixed products there, you don't have just one export health certificate, you have multiple health export certificates that go across, which again comes back to the potential problems that can arise as each and every single one of them. Now, if we had a common health arrangement with Europe that recognised that animal health arrangements in Scotland and the UK were same as Europe, you could look at a huge simplification of the export health certificates. You could look at mutual recognition of standards here and across Europe, which simplifies all that process, and also ultimately can lead to less inspections as products move through border controls. Second bit, in terms of public health, it is at the moment, easiest way to describe it is that each meat product that leaves this country has to be stamped, and it's through that stamp is the way that we verify that our public health arrangements meet the public health arrangements in Europe. Now, again, with that is a lot of cost, there's a lot of veterinary times in terms of inspecting products, and there's paperwork that's associated with that. So if we could get our public health arrangements with Europe with this recognition of our public and the processes that we have in place are equivalent or the same as the process they have in place in Europe, there's opportunity to simplify that documentation, there's opportunity to simplify the inspections that take place, which ultimately leads to a reduction in costs and eases the frictions of movements of products to Europe. So I'll stop at this stage.
OK, that's great. Thanks. I'm going to bring in Mr Stewart, then Ms Forbes.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. You've all touched on the complexities that you've had to face, and these are mainly logistical or bureaucratic, you've indicated this morning. But the complexities of trying to manage that have been, you've already said this morning, it's a burden in your businesses and how you manage that. And it's about how you cope with managing that burden. We've asked others in the past about how they've managed to keep track of the changes that are happening within the EU and what impact that's had within your own sector. I think all of you will probably say that that has added cost, that it may have added personnel into new people having to deal with the new rules and regulations that have had to come into place, and that's been a financial cost to you. And that, in turn, has then a knock-on effect within your own bottom line about what you're trying to achieve, and that may have meant that you have lost commercial opportunities because of that. So I think you've all explained that, but it would be useful to get a flavour as to what burden you've actually seen within your own sector. And that, as I say, is a financial burden, but it's also a people burden about trying to manage that and how you've coped with having to take on the new regulations and how you've managed the number of staff, or have you had to increase just to deal with that on a day-to-day basis to try and wade through the logistical and the bureaucratic issues that you have. So it'd be good to get a flavour from each of you of that. Donna, thank you.
Thanks very much for your question. For ourselves as an organisation, we've actually had to be brought in three consultants, and we were funded by Scottish Government through the food and drink team immediately to bring on Brexit specialists. So They were there as a support mechanism for the companies, so to try and help them navigate through things, ensure there were the correct commodity codes, to be the liaison with UK government, with Scottish government, to highlight all the problems that were going on, what could be done, to do webinars, etc., and really try and help support that. So again, and that's us just dropping that off now, though we still continue to have... we'll have monthly meetings still with industry and with UK government, DEFRA, Scottish government, as well, still on the continuing issues that we have. But for organisations, you know, it's not just the additional cost of people that they've had to do. It's a lost opportunity as well. You know, it really is. They've had to stop and strategically looking at their businesses and be very operational focused. And that was even in the lead up to Brexit, of really trying to ensure that they were ready for Brexit. And we had, obviously, COVID as well, but real focus on that. And then having to the realisation that the systems didn't work on day one of Brexit, you know. So it really has, you know, people have had to bring in new finance people, you know, but they've also had to then reduce that in other areas because, you know, they just can't cover all of that cost burden because it's not just that people, it's your additional cost to get the product to market as well.
Thank you. Scott, and then Tamish.
Thank you. For this, I think I'll split into the impact on large processors and small processors because there is a significant difference, and it's also about that capacity to deal with the situation. So in the first 6 months, for everyone in the industry, it was a huge learning curve. You know, there was no textbook, no template that people could follow because they hadn't been used to dealing with this in terms of dealing with Europe before. So the costs were exceptionally high in the first six months, and then thereafter they've reduced. So I'm going to concentrate on what's in place now rather than what happened in the first six months. So if you look at one of the large processors in Scotland, they operate not just in Scotland, but they operate elsewhere within the United Kingdom. And what they have is a central team who basically are to keep abreast with what needs to be done and provide the training that's required in each individual meat plant under their group to comply with the rules necessary. Then within the individual meat plant within Scotland, they've got a team within that meat plant who are to deal with all the paperwork. So from the export health certificates to the liaison with the haulage companies to transferring all those documentations backwards and forwards. What they also need to employ is an agent based at the BCPs across in Europe, because what they have found is that while it's a common set of rules, the approaches taken at the BCPs can be quite different in terms of the vet inspections that are done, what individual vets are looking for at each point. There's a bit of discretion open to them as to what they can concentrate on. And they need somebody there to manage those situations as they arise and make sure that there's then swift throughput and addition of information or correction of information if it's required. So what one of the large processors have told me is that they send 5 containers each week across to Europe, and they reckon that the increase in cost to them in terms of just that staffing and processing the paperwork, so not the actual physical haulage at all of the product across there, is an extra £6,000 per week. Is what they incur. So over the course of the year, that's an extra £300,000, which is just dead cost that has been sucked out of the business. Now, if you've got a meat business which is operating in a good year on a profit margin of 1.5%, you could see that that's a huge cost associated with it. Now, if you move to a smaller meat processor, many have just simply given up, because to try and learn and comply with those rules is virtually impossible. But it has to be said that within Scotland, within the meat processing industry, both large and meat processors, small meat processors tend to try and help one another. So while they are aggressively competing for business all the time, they also actually work collectively together to try and access new markets because it's a benefit for everyone. So for a smaller meat processor who's still exporting and still using groupage, one of the few who are doing so, what they say is that at the outset of Brexit, they had a member of staff who was spending about 20 hours a week doing the work. They're now down to spending only 8 hours a week doing this activity. So, and they reckon it costs them roughly about £600 to shift two and a half pallets each week to Europe. So again, £600 may not seem much, but that's not haulage cost, but that's just extra fixed costs that are associated on it. And that's only 2.5 pallets of product that's going to Europe, which again is on a very small, tight profit margin.
David?
Yeah, Mr. Stewart, I suppose the boom has been in consultants, as Donna has indicated, and in flights and train journeys to London, because we all spend a lot more time going to London now than we did before because of what's happened. I agree with Scott's point about, you know, that first 6 months. The brutal reality for the salmon industry is we just didn't harvest in that first period after we left the European Union because no one knew what was going to happen to the market. And business, as you well know, take business decisions based on uncertainty, and therefore that was the, in terms of fulfilling contracts, that was a challenging time. Where we are now, as Scott and Donna rightly reflect, is we're used to the systems, we have taken those costs, we meet them ourselves, the customer doesn't want those costs passed on, so they are just part of business costs, and I've indicated what they are for our sector. The slight difference between us and smaller smaller operators in the seafood sector is, by definition, salmon is transported in one lorry, as it were. It's one product in one lorry, as opposed to the groupage arrangements that Donna spoke to some moments ago. And that makes it a little bit easier in terms of what happens when fish arrives in Boulogne-sur-Mer. Boulogne-sur-Mer is, as it were, the centre of the universe when it comes to France and comes to the logistics operation. And if I was recommending an overseas trip for this committee, Boulogne-sur-Mer is a great place to learn about how logistics work and indeed how seafood works. There's also a fantastic restaurant down at the docks, but that's for a different discussion. The point there, as Scott rightly says, is that we as an industry have had to have more people in station to monitor what's going on. And in addition, the new arrangements means that our fish is now sampled to a much greater extent. Because we are a third country, there is greater sampling of our product, which creates some challenges in terms of how that's carried out, the consistency of that process, what that then does to our fish, to be blunt, when it then goes to the customer. So there's some additional challenges there, and we speak to the French authorities regularly on that, and indeed the European authorities on that as well. So that is the practical effect of the changes that have happened at border control points, which in this case is Boulogne-sur-Mer, for certainly for salmon and indeed for more generally for seafood. So in short, additional cost and additional paperwork. How would we get around that? Why we're spending time in London is with DEFRA, the UK department for this area of responsibility, trying to get in place this electronic European health certificate. That's what we need. We all need that. And we've frankly been banging our head against a brick wall for 4 years now on that. And success. And look, very fair engagement with ministers and officials, but they haven't got it done. We've been told that salmon would be easier to trial because it's one product in one lorry, therefore easier in terms of paperwork and so on and so forth. But we're still no further on. And I frankly don't think we'll see any sign of a European health certificate in electronic form this side of a UK general election. What happens thereafter, who knows? But that single measure, as Scott and Donna have both reflected, would make a considerable improvement to our systems and help us export.
OK. Thank you. And Fiona?
I mean, our perspective from Scottish quality crops is kind of maybe unique. So for all we assure 90% of Scotland's combinable crops, we only employ one person, and that's our managing director, Theresa Dougal. So, you know, like the others, consultants brought in to help with the R&D complexity. But the strain on an individual as well is significant. That was a huge job, and of course we worry that RED2 is just the start. There's now RED3, so we have seriously considered whether the time and cost is worthwhile, because we always have an eye on value to the members. our directors are made up of various, you know, maltsters, millers, buyers, NFUS. I'm employed by Scotland Rural College. So the cost borne by those organisations supporting. So it's a major concern.
Okay. Thank you, Camille.
Thanks so much for being here this morning. I guess a lot of our discussion so far has centred on the challenges that you're facing just now or have been facing. And I'd quite like to move to the future. And there's really two angles to my question. One is the prospect of positive change. And then the second is, if there is none, what might be the long-term impact on markets in terms of producers' priorities and customers' preferences? So on the first part, I've asked a number of our stakeholders this question, but do you think that the prospect of change is particularly high? And does the evidence that you supply have any bearing, in your view, on what the politicians and the negotiators might do in terms of a review of the TCA? Does it just boil down to pure politics? Or is there a root in there? You know, we've seen in the last few months where, for example, there have been changes around Horizon, but there's been a lot of things that haven't changed. So that's really the substance of my first question. I might come back to the second question after you've answered, because there's a lot in asking two at the same time. So that first question, what prospect for change is there and how do you enact change?
Yes, happy to have a go at that. Great question, and I'll try and avoid getting into politics because that's not what I'm paid to do. The prospect of change in the context of a UK general election is, from a business perspective, is important. And if nothing else, a resetting of a relationship between the UK and the EU would be welcome. If nothing else, Ms. Forbes, that would be a welcome and significant change for us. And business sees that opportunity and would support that, and is not slow at the moment to be offering the policy prescriptions and the ideas that would make trading with Europe as the core market for certainly for salmon, as you well know from your constituency, fundamentally easier. One practical example: the Norwegians at the moment can use bulk bins, recycled bulk bins, which are collapsible and once clean can then be taken back to Norway and used again. We'd love to be able to use those from Scotland. There's environmental advantages, there's packaging advantages, there are efficiency advantages. The European regulations are 4 years out of date in this world. So if we see an improved trading arrangement, even at top level, never mind some of the details we've talked to today, but even at top level between London and Brussels, those kind of improvements in terms of how we provide the product into France and into the European bloc could be enhanced, because we'd have an ability to make that case. At the moment, that door's pretty well shut. So I am very supportive of anything that would lead to that better trading arrangement, and our businesses would welcome that and welcome a government that wants to take that forward. And from there on, we would see some potential to instigate some of the changes we've talked to this morning about making the practicalities of trade easier.
Thanks.
So I agree with what Tatfish has said there, and I'll come back to politics in a minute, but just look at the commercial situation just now. So up until this point in time, it's basically been a one-way problem. So we've had all the hassle and problems of getting into Europe, and we've been speaking to our counterparts across in Europe about this, but they've had no issues at all in terms of sending their products here to the UK. So from a commercial point of view, there's not been much noise in Europe because they've not noticed any difference. And while they may sympathise with the situation that we've been in, again, from a commercial point of view, why would they want to make anything simpler? Because they've had the benefit of it. There's now a lot of discussions within the meat trade just about how complex it could be. And I use the term could, because we've still got to see all different processes that will be put in place in time, but how complex it could be in terms of getting products into the UK. So I think from a commercial sense, you will get commercial bodies lobbying their respective governments, lobbying the European Commission to say, look, we've got long-established trading arrangements here with the UK. Let's try and make these simpler for everyone, because customers still want the product. We've got lots of added costs being put on here. How can we simplify the process? So I think politicians will come under a lot more pressure in due course to do something about it. And hence, then, moving on to the politics, and I think just picking up on Tavish's point, it's about resetting that relationship with Europe and basically saying there's a win-win for everyone involved here if we can get to a common situation going forward, which comes back to my points about animal health and public health in terms of saying any agreement we can have with Europe would be bespoke. It can be whatever both sides agree upon, so we can have a look at different components of it and look at what components make sense, what components can give the biggest, you know, degrees of freedom and flexibility within the future.
Oh, thanks, Ms. Forbes. And just to build on again what Tavish and Scott are saying about we really do need that better relationship with the EU. I think as an industry, we felt like we had no negotiating power after Brexit. We felt like we gave away such a lot and Europe didn't. So that obviously that they're just starting to feel the effects of things coming into play from the 1st of April. And it'd be really interesting to see how that plays out. Because our fear up until, you know, we didn't know, you know, until the last minute, you know, could it be worse? You know, could we have tariffs, yeah, you know, again? So again, you know, we need to be ensuring, you know, because that could be the next step on renegotiations, that, you know, they start discussing tariffs. And so we need a good relationship so we're not in a worse position. You know, we're in a bad position now. We're getting better with it, but it can be worse. You know, we can be having tariffs as well. So that, and, you know, will make the situation very bad for the industry. Mm.
If I could just come back on one point, it's that managing the relationship, I think, is hugely important. And if we give a bit of an analogy, when the commercial businesses started exporting to Europe, all these different problems that arose at the BCP, whichever agent you have in place is actually very critical to that, because they build up a relationship and understanding with the people that are working across there. They build up a level of trust, so they know that X business actually does things correctly. You know, the X business, you can rely upon them, that if there is an error, they quickly correct that error. And it's somebody there physically managing that process. And I would turn that to then, it's about the government as well, that whatever agreement is hopefully reached in the future that improves things, it's not just that day that agreement is signed, but it's that actively managing that relationship going forward. So that as issues arise, as problems arise, there's a two-way open dialogue between both sides, with the mindset that they actually want to resolve problems rather than the mindset of actually wanting to, you know, make things sticky and make things problematic. So relationships are hugely important in this area.
Okay, Fiona?
I reject that point, that sort of resetting the relationship and managing it positively would be a positive future. Again, our perspectives may be slightly skewed by the fact that we're net importers, which may have, you know, made it easier for stuff coming in. Again, potatoes not in the SQC scheme, but the contrast where we're still unable to export seed potatoes to Europe, and that has just become stuck. You know, trade is only one way that plant health, diseases, pests move about. So I think on a kind of detailed level, the system where SASA works closely with DEFRA, the plant health officers cooperate, At that detailed level, there's good exchange of information, and again, that's really positive, but it's just unblocking some of these sticky issues. And again, I come back to the worry that if we get divergence from Europe in terms of, you know, safety on grain, mycotoxins or chemicals, that's a worry, because we wish our scheme to be equivalent and recognised in Europe to reduce the burden on growers, where the worst case scenario is that they're having to operate to multiple assurance schemes.
Thank you. Yeah. Again, Kate, yeah.
Appreciate that, and it's perhaps a little bit more optimistic and hopeful than I was anticipating, so that's good. But on my second question then, what does the market, how do your markets change over the coming years? So, I mean, the evidence from salmon is just remarkable. I'm going to quote from the briefing, 2019, 53,000 tonnes of Scottish salmon exported to the EU, 23 volumes near 44,000. Is that a trend? And secondly, obviously Scottish salmon, UK's biggest food export in 23, France and the US leading global demand. This is essential to Scotland's economy. I mean, you're all essential to Scotland's economy. But for there to be such a substantial drop, if that is not reversed and if there is not prospect of significant growth in food exports, for example, then Scotland becomes poorer. That's pretty devastating. What do you see the future looking like in terms of your industries, and how do we ensure that our nation isn't poorer for your industries being impacted?
Can I have a first go at that? Thank you for that very good question. I mean, I am optimistic about the future, Ms. Forbes, be no shadow of a doubt about that, not least of which because the demand for salmon and indeed for seafood worldwide and therefore from Scotland is phenomenal, and we actually nearly can't keep up with it at times. I mean, the continuity of supply is quite a significant factor for us as a sector at the moment, and while that's a real challenge with certain markets, it's in some ways a great challenge to have because we've got that ability to scale up in a sustainable and appropriate way with all the regulation that we deal with as an industry, and we should be, and are regulated. So the backside to that is absolutely fine and fair. My view of the way it's going to go over the next 5-10 years is that as long as we can sustainably grow in Scotland, and that means some of the reforms that we've been working with your government with here at home, then the marketplace is very strong for our future. But it is wider than just the EU now. So we can rebuild that market share in Europe, although we do that in a dose of heavy competition, I think it'd be fair to say, with our friends to the east, based mostly in Bergen, but that's just the nature of business and the nature of markets. But the other markets that we have worked really hard in salmon terms, and Don and I are both just back from Boston, because that's the centrepiece of the North American seafood market and the expo that takes place there, is how is that going to grow and how significantly is that going to grow? And the answer is it will. And Scotland's salmon producing companies have great export opportunities in those emerging markets and indeed in North America, a mature market, but also to the Far East, and Donna can speak to this far better than I can, but I just think that potential is very significant indeed. So the future over the next 5-10 years is absolutely Scotland can grow. And then to your economic point, if we grow, we employ more people, we create more taxation income for your government, we create more local jobs in constituencies, the length and breadth of the country, something I'm very proud of indeed. And we also grow our supply chain, which is highly significant now in terms of the money that goes back into the Scottish economy that fuels much-needed economic growth. So I applaud the Scottish Government's export policy paper that I know you had a very significant part of in the past. That kind of overarching vision of where our sector can be, along with colleagues right across this table, I think is where we need to drive forward on, and we need to do our bit by making sure all the things we do at a production level are right, and we can fulfil that emerging and ever-growing market need.
Thank you again, Ms Forbes, for your question on... So we are the trade marketing body for Scottish seafood, and we are funded by Scottish Government through the Marine Fund Scotland, and we are there to ensure that we are getting a premium price for our seafood. Seafood is highly exportable. You know, around 80% of our seafood is exported, and around 80% of that goes to Europe. So it's our biggest market by far. But we have to de-risk that reliance on that marketplace. And how do we do that? So we have been looking at other key markets, as we have throughout the years. We have in-market specialists as well, which is an industry-government partnership that we have. And we have boots on the ground in key global markets as well. But really looking at where are the opportunities for seafood. So as Tavish says, we're just back from the Seafood Expo North America, and really looking at, that's our second biggest market for seafood. How can we grow that market? Our third biggest market is China. So how do we grow that? So again, it's being able to be out and be visible at the China Seafood Show, but also as well opportunities such as showcasing Scotland and bringing the Chinese buyers and other buyers to Scotland, because we want to showcase Scotland, the people, the place and product. But it is, and it's the looking at the Japanese markets, really being aware of where are going to be the next key markets. So we're currently scoping out South Korea, a fantastic opportunity for salmon in South Korea, but also we've now got landing targets for mackerel. So there's going to be more mackerel increasing landings in Scotland. So where do we find markets for that? So again, it's scoping out, looking at new market opportunities as well, which takes time. It all takes time. It's all additional costs at the moment, ensuring the logistics are all there. So it takes a bit of convincing with companies to then move from a secure marketplace, even though it's costing them more, to then take that. So they need a bit of hand-holding through that and making sure it's the correct move for them. But de-risking the European market, I think, is key, spreading that risk, but also trying to get as much premium for your product as you can and not be treated as a commodity.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, the red meat industry isn't as export focused as salmon or seafood, but three out of every four farms in Scotland are in livestock production, and therefore anything that happens to the red meat industry processing sector ultimately are felt by the farms in Scotland and has an impact on in terms of the land in Scotland. Now, for us, if we split again into just a few different sections, is that we've already saw some of the smaller meat processors and one recently go out of business in the last month. Not a single factor could be put down to it, but one of the factors would have been the loss of export markets. That would have had a contributing factor to it. In terms of large meat processors, it's all about carcass balance and all about different points of the year. So, you know, you've got to achieve that carcass balance to make money. And therefore, the European market and markets for the field are hugely important to processors in terms of achieving that. It's also worth noting that we're not volume producers here in Scotland. So we're not looking for a big volume market in Europe. We simply wouldn't have that production to fulfil it. But what we do is we target premium markets in Europe. So they're high value markets, which return, in theory, a high value margin back to Scotland. And it's also a good promotion in terms of Scotland abroad. So whether that's Scotch beef or Scotch lamb or Scotch pork, all these are highly valued across Europe in different areas. So again, going back to something that I commented on before, I think it was a crying shame where we are not able now to export to Monaco, for instance, because the promotion of Scotch beef in Monaco has a huge benefit in terms of how Scotland is generally perceived worldwide. What I would say is that in terms of us going forward, what's the impact? It's difficult to disentangle the impact of exports by other factors. So whether it's labour issues, which are hugely important, which also tie into Brexit, or whether it's about limited supply of cattle numbers in Scotland going forward. All these are factors that have to be played. But as a commercial processor, what you'd be looking for is as many market opportunities as possible, because it's through those market opportunities that you hope to, at the end of the day, have enough money that allows you to keep the plants operating in Scotland, helps you keep the jobs that you have in Scotland, which isn't just about the meat plant itself, but it's about all the infrastructure that surrounds it. And I say, we are just, say, the middle part of that whole food supply chain that starts at the farm, goes through the processor, then ultimately ends with the consumer.
I mean, Scotland produces some of the highest yielding and highest quality crops in the world, but combinable crops clearly trade as a commodity, so the prices are kind of heavily influenced globally. But that said, easy trade helps to stiffen prices and add premiums, and where that's difficult, you know, prices soften. So there's a kind of immediate effect there from hard or easy ability to trade. But clearly, you know, strongly linked to the food and drink sector. So again, their ability to trade easily, and as others have said, that idea that we can add, you know, premiums to what we're trading. You know, clearly the ambition is to produce sustainably and demonstrate that, and that feeds through to, you know, what food and drink can talk about. So our ability to grow, our ambition to grow, is there. But it has to be easy to trade.
Thank you. Thanks.
Thank you. Other Mr. Stewart.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to you all. I'm pleased to hear about some of the positivity that you see for the future, if there is change. But I want to concentrate on some of the things that has been said this morning and some of the things in your submission. And Ms. Forbes already has referred to the Salmon Scotland submission and that loss of export value of £80 to £100 million from 2019 is pretty immense in my book. And that is there in black and white. But what is maybe unquantifiable is some of the loss that there has been that has been mentioned by Mr. Walker and Ms. Ferdice this morning around about the impacts on particularly smaller producers, smaller companies, because of the changes to the like of groupage. And I would like to maybe tease out a little bit more around about that, because that has obviously led to some market shrinkage, I would imagine. Probably hasn't done quite so well for Scotland, the brand, which we all want to see being up there. So I maybe if we could expand a little bit more on that groupage difficulties. Mr. Walker, you mentioned the fact that the main way out of the UK now is through Hull to Zeebrugge, and that has shrunk markets. You mentioned Monaco just not minutes ago. Could you give us an indication of where our product is not reaching anymore because of these changes?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, and just for clarification, so the Hull to Zeebrugge route is the groupage route. So again, across the channel would be the main route for the large processors in Scotland. But because of Hull to Zeebrugge and the onward connections, what I understand is the likes of Portugal, Italy and Monaco, for instance, are markets that's just no longer possible to deliver the product either in the time frame that would be required or at a cost that would be acceptable to the marketplace. And again, what you're talking about here is, you know, premium product that would be going to, you know, some of the best hotels, some of the best establishments in the world, which are, as I say, very good in terms of promoting Scotland and for what is produced here in Scotland. So what that has meant for individual processors is either downgrading the product, in essence, selling it to a lesser market, perhaps here in the United Kingdom, or where they still sell abroad is accepting a far smaller margin than they had previously. And as I say, over the last month, we've had one meat processor in Scotland that has gone out of business.
So obviously Salmon Scotland have been able to quantify that devaluation in export. You've mentioned there, you know, missing out on markets in Portugal and Italy and other places. Do you have a figure of the devaluation of that export market over the period?
It's not something that Scottish Association of Meat Wholesalers collect themselves. I would have to turn to Quality Meat Scotland to try and get them to calculate a figure for the committee.
Okay. Ms. Ferdice, obviously, you know, there are some processors still in Aberdeen, some smaller ones who maybe are not exporting anymore because of the groupage situation. What are they telling you?
So three of them have actually went out of business. So there's three went out of business. We know from the larger businesses that they have picked up the orders that have been dropped off from the smaller companies. You know, so there doesn't seem to be a reduction in trade to Europe around seafood. It's just it's moved to the larger organisations who can cope with that. But it's reduced the turnover of the smaller companies. So they're now just competing in that UK market. We are working with some of them to get them into the Middle East market because it's actually easier to get into Dubai than it is to get into Europe. But for the majority, there is a reduction in their turnover, and which is compounded as well with the labour issue. So again, they don't have the ability to process as much product as they can on that smaller labour issue because of the reliance on Eastern European workforce. So across Scotland, there was 52% Eastern European workforce in the seafood sector, but 78% in the northeast, and in some factories up to 90% reliance on Eastern European workforce. So when you've hit COVID and then you've hit Brexit and we cannot be replacing these people, or it's very expensive visa processes that a lot of them are going through, these smaller companies can't do that either. So again, the shrinkage in turnover is because loss of market, but also the loss of people to be able to process.
Thank you. Mr. Scott, do you have anything to add? You've got pretty substantial figures here that you've quantified.
Well, thank you. Loss. No, thank you, Mr. Stewart. We just simply sought to give you some indication of what, and it is an estimate in fairness, because market trends would change over year periods as well. The only other thing I was going to add to Donna and Scott's point, which I hope would be helpful, is one of the initiatives we were discussing before we came in to see you this morning is Edinburgh Airport's plans for a freight hub. An air freight hub. And I appreciate wider concerns about transport by air, but that's the reality of business. And we all very much welcome the initiatives that have been shown by the airport sector in Scotland to develop direct links to the kind of markets that Donna's just been describing. That would be advantageous for Scottish business and advantageous for our futures. So I would suggest that the foresight of the Edinburgh Airport team, certainly in bringing forward some business-ready solution there for us, would be quite significant in the longer term as well. And maybe something also of use to smaller businesses in the context of the groupage that you were asking about.
An air hub maybe promoting sustainable aviation fuel would be the way forward. Ms. Burnett, I recognise that things are a little bit different for you in these regards, but Scottish seed potatoes were quite a thing. The impact and that inability to export must be huge on companies. Can you give us an indication of what they have had to bear because of these changes?
Yeah, I mean, as I mentioned earlier, the issues around seed potato trade with Europe are unresolved, so it's welcome that trade through the Windsor Agreement with Ireland has resumed. But yes, that ambition to trade more globally. Again, potatoes don't sit in our scheme, so I don't have numbers, you know, in my head. I think a lot of that trade now, you know, Europe, Egypt, for example, so out with Europe has become a major market. But Spain, Italy used to be major markets for seed potatoes. So the need to resolve that is obvious.
Gone for the moment.
That's gone for the moment.
Which we need to get back.
And there seems to be no prospect of that resolving quickly at the moment.
Mr. Walker.
Yeah, perhaps if I could talk about potatoes, which may be strange as I'm here today for the Scottish Association of Meat Wholesalers, but I'm also part-time chief executive with GB Potatoes, so involved in the potato trade. So in terms of seed potatoes, as has already been said, that market to Europe was closed overnight. You know, in Scotland, we're particularly high grade seed is what's considered, and therefore vital to the European market, which is now suffering from a lot of various diseases within Europe. What you saw happen in the seed potato trade is that the varieties changed. So what seed potato producers have done is they grow the varieties that are suitable for the markets that they wish to sell to. So what most have done is that they've shifted to varieties now for the Egyptian market. Now, the problem with Egypt is that while it's been very, I'll say, good for the last couple of years, what we now are is very heavily reliant upon the Egyptian market for exports. That dominates where our seed potatoes go to. And over the course of time, the Egyptian market, I'll describe as best as being volatile. So at some point of time, we would expect we'll run into problems in terms of supplying the Egyptian market. So that's why looking at alternative markets are hugely important. So there's initiatives in place to bring overseas representatives from other markets to Scotland to walk them through what SASA do here, how growers produce here. And there is still a lot of work going on in place in terms of opening up the European potato market. Now, on that, it has been very positive in terms of potato growers in Europe because they're actually lobbying very hard the European Commission to get access to Scottish seed because there's a huge shortage in terms of Scottish seed, in terms of seed potatoes at this moment. So while I don't see anything happening imminently there, I do believe that there is genuine focus of trying to reopen that market, and it would be, you know, genuine favour on the ground in Europe to get Scottish seed back into Europe.
Thank you. Jack of all trades and master of many, it seems, Mr. Walker. I know that you don't really want to talk about politics to any huge degree. Mr. Scott has made that plain, but we are on the run-up to a general election. And obviously, you have pointed out today in your submissions and have been talking about this for some time, around about European health certificate, around about getting the public health certification right, getting those public health arrangements right, and cutting down on bureaucracy. So what would your plea be to those candidates that are standing in the forthcoming general election? And I know that you all see this as being very high in your agenda, but what should these politicians, future politicians, be thinking of in terms of their own policy priorities, and how high up the agenda should this be for them? Mr. Scott.
Yeah, look, it's a very fair question, I really do, and in no way are we avoiding it. I think in some ways we've already answered it, because we've already all talked to the importance of a better trading relationship between the country, with the EU, and that is the fundamentals to it. You can get into the detail, and you've illustrated your knowledge of that by the subjects you've mentioned today, but that is the fundamental. We need a reset, as Donna used the phrase reset. We all need a reset of that trading relationship, so we'd all be looking for aspiring politicians and aspiring governments in London to want to be in that place. And I'm pleased to say that we see some signs of that. So that's encouraging for us as business people trying to grow the Scottish economy and grow our businesses within that Scottish economy. And that's what I think that's the simplest way to answer your very fair question.
Ms. Verdice.
Yeah, I agree wholeheartedly with Tavish, and you know, whenever we get an opportunity, we just remind people, we don't lobby, but we remind people, you know, how important it is to the sector. So just trying to keep it at the forefront of everybody's minds as well, of how difficult this is, you know, and you know how little things could probably make things a lot easier for us. But it just feels like for some things, it can just keep getting kicked down the road, especially with the digitised system. So, yeah, there's things, solutions there.
Thank you. Ms. Burnett?
I would just concur with what others have said. Yeah.
I would say if you had to commit, you know, if this was down to business, you know, business in Europe and business here in the UK, I'm sure this could all be simplified in a very, very short period of time. So I would be asking all politicians to leave the baggage of the past behind them and look at, you know, what's in the benefit of the people of Scotland, the people of the United Kingdom. Where are we going to create jobs? Where are we going to create wealth? Where are we going to retain the jobs and retain the wealth that we currently have here? And from a pure commercial point of view, we need to get an improvement on the deal that we currently have with the European Union.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you very much. Mr. Bibby.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning to the panel. I mean, we've discussed extensively the need for change, the impact, and how difficult the situation is and how difficult negotiations can be. I guess, for example, my question is, we've heard support today and previously for a veterinary agreement to be sought as soon as possible, and as a matter of urgency, which makes a lot of sense. But we've also heard from the Scottish Fishermen's Federation, who have said they couldn't support a veterinary agreement because the TCA is so currently harmful to the UK's fishing rights. So I guess my question is, how does the committee balance those different views, and are these just unavoidable trade-offs?
So Mr. Bibby asks a very fair question, Convener, and I read that Scottish Fishermen's Federation submission last night as well for this session this morning. And you're right, these are trade-offs. I mean, didn't we half go through a trade-off some years ago on all these issues? I suspect, and others would know better than me, but I know from home in Shetland that there are probably some fishermen today who take a different view of the European Union than they might have done in the past, without getting into the delicate area of fishing politics. The skippers I speak to just in day-to-day life, never mind anything I do in the salmon sector, are business people. and the bottom line, as Donna has spoken to, is where is their market? How are they able to run successful businesses? And that's where we all are. So I think there's actually... I'd hope not to be accused of being naive about this, but I think there's now a much more business focus about what those negotiations need to look like from our perspective in terms of the salmon sector or others. And while the Scottish Fishermen's Federation have every right to point out that linkage that happened all those years ago, the TCA renegotiation in 2 years' time is an opportunity, we think, from a business point of view, to make sure that the starting point is how do we improve trade. And the fishing industry, I think it would be fair to say, Donna, we speak to this as well, the fishing industry, the fish catching sector, know that too, because they know what their market future looks like as well. So as long as, it's kind of Scott's point, as long as we're allowed to put, what is in the interest of growing the economy, which I think most politicians of all political parties are pretty signed up to do, which we very strongly welcome, then, Mr. Bibby, my view is that yes, there'll be tricky trade-offs, but actually, as long as we look at what grows the economy at a time when the UK has been in recession, I'd have thought saner heads will bear fruit in terms of coming up with a solution which is accepting those trade-offs, but only producing a trade agreement which is better news for the British economy.
I don't know if Donna's got anything to add to that.
Probably for myself and my position, I mean, the majority of my board are fishermen, are the fishing organisations and the producer organisations as well. So I suppose it's trying to get the best of both worlds in as much as we can. You know, how do we do these trade-offs, but making sure everyone's as happy as they can be with what we can get, and it's not a major trade-off one for the other. That hopefully, you know, it's important for the economy, you know, because if we don't have enough fish, if we don't have enough product, then, you know, it's going to have a detrimental impact on business. So we need to ensure that we're getting our fair share of the waters to allow us to catch more to grow the economy as well. So it's that balancing act, and hopefully if we have a lot better relationship, you know, that we could come out with a better deal for all.
Thank you. I don't know if Scott or Fiona has anything on that.
I recognise the issues that have been highlighted, but I don't think it would be appropriate for me to comment on the fishing industry.
Fairly. Thanks, Kevin. Mr.
Driscoll.
Thanks. I wanted to ask you about cheques coming in the other way from EU to UK and whether that might change the dynamic a little bit here. Scott, did you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I think it will. I think it's got to. And already the word that we're hearing from meat processors in Europe is it's changing their attitude to things. And I think from just a simple perspective, you can see why. Post-Brexit, from a European exporter importing to the UK, they notice no difference at all. So Brexit was all, much to do about nothing, really. And all we've saw time and time again, and we've commented on that every time that the checks and inspections were going to be put in place, we saw that as going to be an opportunity to bring both parties to the table to negotiate. So we are now this year getting in place those checks and inspections being put in place. Are they going to be the same as we face in Europe? I don't think they are, but we'll have to wait and see once they're all rolled out. But what they are going to do is, for the first time, cause friction for European exporters wanting to get product into Europe. And hence, I think it comes back down to those commercial businesses will now be speaking to their respective governments, will be speaking to the European Commission and saying, we need to look at simplifying the process. We need to look at how we can make this trade just simpler and remove some of the cost and the admin and the time that's currently associated with it. So I thank it that these barriers in the UK side are eventually going to be put in place.
And Fiona, you're saying that your sector is a net importer.
Yeah.
So specifically, how do you see things panning out once these checks are brought in?
I think because grain is deemed low risk in the risk model, that it's a fairly pragmatic system at the minute. That grain coming in, I think the fee is about £30 a tonne. That operates relatively smoothly. I know that our plant health inspectors are otherwise pressured at major markets. So the kind of resource that they need to inspect other higher risk crops, including potatoes, that's a kind of separate issue. But as regards the combinable crops and grain, I think, the trade that comes in is relatively smooth.
And I'm presuming with salmon and shellfish, that's less of an issue about your colleagues that operate the continent importing to the UK. But I suppose it does raise a question about how your sectors are working with your European compatriots and in the sort of political context that we have to affect EU regulations and change. So, Tavish, I'm aware that the vast majority of salmon farms in Scotland are owned by Norwegian companies. Now, does that give you potentially an advantage with Norway being in the EEA to then influence European Union through that route? Is that, as a kind of multinational industry, does that give you an advantage and a voice beyond London?
Not really, to be honest, because they're separate business entities. The Norwegian, two of our companies are Norwegian owned out of the six. The other one's Faroese and one's Canadian. So there's, but the point that you make on Norway is important. But no, it doesn't. We don't necessarily gain any leverage of that. Believe me, the Norwegian sector supplies into the European market with great gusto and in full competition with Scotland, and that's appropriate in market circumstances. Just one point on the import that you asked Scott about. We are already seeing some impact of that because we use border control points both in the Falkirk Council area and in the Highland Council area. And that has created an additional burden on, if I may say so, hard-working and local government environmental officers and other staff in those local authority areas. So there is an impact on local government at a time when I appreciate it's really, things are extremely tight. So we are already seeing a bit of that, but I think Scott makes a very fair point. There'll be a European dynamic to this quite quickly, and we do work with our opposite numbers. There's a European Trade Association in terms of farmed fish, so you can imagine sea bass in the Mediterranean, so on and so forth. We work with colleagues from Spain and Greece and others on all these issues, as much to understand the intelligence of or the direction of travel of European policy in the way in which we used to when we were members of the Union.
Sure. Be involved in rule making, not just rule taking. Donna, do you have anything to add on that in terms of how, as a sector, you're kind of operating?
I think there's been a huge, you know, the industry movement. Continually, all I hear is it's an unfair, unlevel playing field. You know, so we've heard that continually. So they're welcoming these checks coming in, and more so is to give us leverage. You know, how can that give us leverage to come around the table again and let's talk? We know there is a lot of talk going on. And I know Scottish Government have been out to France and meeting with Boulogne-sur-Mer and trying to make things easier at the border control points, and trying to understand if there's any other issues that we could be doing back here. So there is a lot of talks going on and making sure how smoothly things... Because, I mean, as Scott says about his customers, you know, our customers as well want our product. They want our premium Scottish seafood. They want it to be as simple as possible. You know, it's just making sure that the right people are around the table making the decisions on how we could have frictionless trade.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I wonder if I could ask a couple of final questions. I guess everything today has reminded us that Brexit wasn't an event, it's a process, and we're still going through that process for some time. We're not just facing UK elections, there's also European elections coming up, which, you know, will delay any kind of movement, although the Commission will be up running fairly soon after that. But one of the things that you've talked about is the importance of those relationships and building the relationships. But what tends to happen with countries is officials do a sort of 3-year rotation and then they move back. And we're now moving into a period where there are a lot of officials in Brussels who don't remember the UK being part of that process and are dealing with it. So do you think the challenges to keep and maintain those relationships are going to be harder going forward? And how much more effort are you having to put into you know, building the key relationships in the organisations that you're working with there? As well, I'll come back to another question about divergence, but if I could just ask that one firstly.
I mean, I think you make a very good point about that relationship that we all used to traditionally have with Brussels. I mean, I can't be the only in my former life of being one of, if I may say so, in this room, going out to Brussels 2 or 3 times a year just to make sure you were making a constituency case or whatever, and that doesn't happen anymore. What are we doing now? We don't do anything like as much as we used to. We do much more direct country to country. So Donna's point about Boulogne-sur-Mer, that is the centre of the universe when it comes to fish imports into the European Union. So we have closer contacts with Paris and with French authorities than we do in that sense with Brussels authorities. What I think we would certainly welcome as a sector is what used to be Scotland House and used to be UKREP. I dare say they've all been renamed and are all something new now, and forgive me for not knowing all what the current... those were always really important touch points for business as well, of course, for politicians and governments and that kind of thing. And once you get to the other side of the UK election, whatever that throws up, I think for business, we'd be really supportive of Scottish Government and others and Parliament playing that role, which facilitated a resetting of that relationship. Sorry to be boring and continue that theme, but I think that resetting relationship would be important for us in terms of even some of the practical issues. I was boring you all with bulk bins, which is just a practical packaging and handling system. We could do with finding the right European Commission officials to be able to have that discussion with, because it takes the European Union a long time to change regulations, but we could do with starting to make that case. So a reset of that would all be enormously helpful, and your role as parliamentarians in encouraging that would be hugely advantageous.
Anyone?
I just want to echo what Tavish has said, really. You know, I think, you know, that relationship is so important, and we don't really have that now. To rebuild that would be fantastic.
So I've got a couple more questions. Donna, you talked specifically mainly about the Sorry, Scott, did you want to come in on that, first question?
Just very quickly. So as an association, we don't have strong links or regular visits in terms of Europe, albeit some of our member organisations, in terms of the businesses, you know, are cross-border, so they have those discussions. But again, in the formal life, when I was within NFU Scotland, again, just seeing how Brussels operates, it is all about relationships. And I think it is, in essence, I'm going to turn it, it's an opportunity. As people move, new ones come in who, again, don't have that baggage of the past. And what we do have, that opportunity, and Tavish touched on it, is that permanent civil service that are based still across in Brussels, so Scotland House, ScotRep, across there. And I think it is about them being seen, being talking to people, making those outward opportunities as much as possible and showing where there's just wins-wins for everyone involved in it. You know, Europe is really built around relationships. You know, Brussels is built around relationships. So the more time that individuals spend there and build up those relationships to work to a sensible outcome, that'll pay dividend for Scotland as a nation.
And just to, I mean, the churn is a good point. It's a concern, that sort of changeover. Plant health, from my perspective, often comes secondary to animal health issues. So, I welcome its inclusion today. And from an SQC perspective, as a very small organisation, the proportional time spent building up new relationships. Again, the Renewable Energy Directive, because it cuts across many issues and departments, it's really complex to form that network of opinions. And when somebody moves on, the whole thing unravels. So that remains an ongoing worry for us.
Okay. And the other area is about regulation and change in Brussels and divergence, as you mentioned earlier on, Fiona. We were hearing from the producers last week about the amount of time that they're having to spend and having consultants, you know, trying to keep on top of the regulations. But we also heard of a producer who had shipped, got onto the continent, and the regulations changed mid-shipment, and they had a huge loss which the business couldn't sustain. So again, that was another producer that decided not to, it was too risky for them then to continue trying to export. Is there more that Welsh and Scottish governments have the keeping pace commitment at the moment, and Northern Ireland of course is in the position of having to keep up with those regulations. Is there enough information being given by both UK government, Scottish government to support producers who are trying to export in that context? And just for yourself, Donna, is that one of the major barriers, or what are the other barriers that are preventing the smaller producers coming on board and coming back in to attempting to do this? As I say, time moves on and we learn some lessons in it. So maybe we'll go to
I think that you're right, picking up on that point of you know, the smaller producers and getting them back into Europe. I think it'll be a real struggle to get them back into Europe, just because it's still cost prohibitive, you know, and unless the customer is willing to pay that extra cost. But they've got other larger organisations who can still supply that. So again, that opportunity is lost, but that's not to say that we couldn't be building on additional markets. And again, that's in Europe, though, you know, the main focus is France. You know, we've gotten a lot of inquiries from Germany, for example, and Italy. So different markets as well in that European Union are really showing interest in Scottish seafood, so looking at new markets. But I think for information, we're still having to set up our own forums. We're still having to push. We had a task force from the UK government, which has turned into the Scottish Seafood Industry Advisory Group, which is co-chaired by John Lamont and with the Cabinet Secretary, Marie Goujon. And it gives us a forum to be talking about things. It's, you know, it's slow. It's very slow, and being able to progress, because some of these are real challenges, you know, especially around the immigration, around the digitisation of the health certificate. We get information coming from DEFRA, and let's say we have our own forums where we invite Scottish Government, DEFRA, UK officials on to actually speak to the industry on a monthly basis. So again, it's still a lot of time and effort being put in by everybody just to keep up to date and just to make sure. And we still have the consultants there that we would pay unrequired if we need to look into to issues, because there's still issues that come up.
Fiona, did you want to?
Yeah, I mean, the two issues we probably worry most about when it comes to divergence are, you know, pesticides, which quite rightly come under proper scrutiny, and also where Europe may go with gene editing. So they're probably two pieces. The food safety issues around mycotoxins, again, kind of standard levels that are safe. And you know, we have many worries at the moment, but maybe, you know, the examples around pesticides are regulated by the, you know, our Chemical Regulations Directorate, but that's now a duplication of what used to go through with equivalents in Europe. The system is slow, so things are approved in Europe before they're approved here. So that feeling that we work at a disadvantage because we don't get new innovations as quickly is a concern.
Does anyone else want to come in? Okay. That's exhausted my questions. I'm looking to committee members to see if there's any further questions. I don't think so. Can I thank you all again? It's been an extremely helpful, extremely informative session for our committee inquiry. And we have enjoyed these experiences as a... We're not a subject committee, so it's quite unusual for us to actually be getting to the sort of frontline issues around this. It's been more about the constitutional aspects, so we really have enjoyed these sessions. So thank you very much. And I now close this session of the committee, and we're going to private session for final agenda item.